Hello and welcome to today's lecture. So we are in our lecture notes and we go today to section 2.6 on the Graham matrix method. And so last time we have learned that every non-negative polynomial in several variables over a real closed field is a sum of squares of rational functions. Unfortunately, in general, not of polynomials. That's what we have seen in the one of the previous times. Why would it be really good if it were a sum of squares of polynomials even? Well, one of the reasons for that would be that we have very good methods of searching for such a representation. And today we want to learn one of these methods, namely the Graham matrix method. And that can be combined with a Newton polytope, and that's what we will also do. Okay, so let K be a Euclidean field, so that's a field where squares form an order, and then that's the unique order. So in particular, K could be a real closed field, or it could even be the real numbers, of course. And F a polynomial in several variables over K. And now the aim, before we go to these technical things, the aim is to test whether f is a sum of squares of polynomials, right? We want to have a tool how to test this. And the tool will be so-called Graham matrices, namely, if f is a sum of squares of polynomials, there exists a PSD matrix, so-called Graham matrix, a symmetric matrix over the Euclidean field K of some size M, such that F is V transpose GV. And now I have to talk about what is V. So actually V will be a vector of monomials. It will be a vector of monomials, a row vector of, a column vector of monomials, right? So you have here a matrix over K times a column vector of monomials, and here we take a transposed vector of monomials, so that's when the corresponding row vector of monomials, right? And so now what do we take for these monomials? So now there are several choices for this, right? So alpha I's are such tuples of non-negative integers, of course, right? N tuples of non-negative integers. And one choice one could make is that you take all tuples such that two times the value of this tuple, that's the sum of its components, is less than or equal the degree of f, right? So think of this as an exponent tuple of a monomial, right? And this means if you multiply the monomial with itself, its degree is at most the degree of f, right? So this will have to do with the fact that we have seen that if f is a sum of squares of polynomials, then each of these polynomials has degree at most 1/2 the degree of f, right? Or 2 times its degree is at most the degree of f. So all monomials that can appear in such a sums of squares representation under the square, they automatically have degree at most 1/2 the degree of f. And so and so I mean, you will see later in the proof that these will be also sufficient for this representation. So instead of such a sums of squares representation, we can have such a representation in the middle where is a matrix over K, and here is a vector of monomials. So you can see this vector of monomials as a vector over the polynomial ring over K, and you can see this matrix also as a matrix over the polynomial ring, since the field is contained in a polynomial ring, and you know, and then so this is a matrix identity over the polynomial ring, if you want, and that is very closely related to such an identity. And because here the monomials under the square have automatically degree at most 1/2 a degree of f, it will turn out that here also looking at those monomials is enough. But you might take a bigger set of monomials, that's completely okay. It's just that this won't help so much. And if you want to, you know, we had this refinement of a degree, which was the Newton polytope. And actually you can, you know, we had also proven similar things for the, so if you have a sums of squares representation of a polynomial, we have also proven something about the Newton polytope of polynomials that are squared. And so we could actually, with this finer thing, we could actually just take the alpha i's to be the elements, to be the tuples of non-negative integers in 1/2 a Newton polytope of f. That would also be enough, right? And here is the general condition which under which it works, right? So if 1/2 a Newton polytope of f intersected the non-negative integer tuples, is contained in the alpha i's, in the set of the alpha i's, and yeah, that's all I need, right? Okay. Good. So this and in fact, you know, I mean, that would be a bit stupid, but you can even take twice the same alpha I here, right? but that there is clearly no advantage in this. But and then you could you know, you might ask, why don't you always take just alpha, the set of the alpha I equal to this? That seems to be the smallest choice. Small choice is good, of course, but of course, yeah, it can also be some effort to compute actually these tuples of non-negative integers contained in this Newton polytope. Even that could be an effort, right? Or sometimes you don't really know it, right? For some, if f is not concretely given, that can also happen. So when you might take a bigger set of alpha i's. And so we're following our equivalent, f is a sum of squares of polynomials, and B, there is a PSD matrix, G. So PSD we had defined with an arbitrary ordered field, 2, 3, 1, B, right? Maybe let's look at it again. What is the definition of a PSD matrix? So it has to be symmetric, and then it's called PSD if X transpose MX is non-negative for all X. Okay. And then, yeah, maybe I should say something more. So you know, this is a polynomial identity. So you could, of course, compare coefficients of on both sides. And what you get then is, of course, You get affine linear constraints on the entries of G. That's what you get, right? So you can see this as a system of affine linear inequalities, a finite system of affine linear inequalities, if you regard the entries of G as unknowns. And so system of linear inequalities, oh, that's something we can deal with, right? That's very easy. But just don't forget there is this PSD condition, right? So, yeah, so this leads to a so-called linear matrix inequality, which one has techniques to deal with very efficiently also, but I won't go into this now, right? We will deal with these PSD condition rather in an ad hoc manner and see that even in an ad hoc manner we can do a lot. But there are better techniques to get under control this condition PSD. So it will later on be very important. So F is a sum of M squares, that's the third condition, so that's a bit finer than this, right? And you know, F is a sum of M squares, yeah, that's gives more information, right? Where m is the number of this alpha I. So for m, you could take this cardinality of 1/2 a Newton polytope intersected with tuples of non-negative integers. So to understand better, I would like to point out that we have already, that you know already about this theorem in a special case, namely, let the special case let be that, that f is a quadratic form. F is a quadratic form. And the Newton polytope of such a quadratic form is contained in a set of all, let's say, A to, in R to N, such that the sum of the the sum of the AIs. I don't use alpha I here because the alpha I's are already these tuples, right? So I don't use them now for exponents. And in fact, here I have even real numbers, so that's anyway different. So sum of the alpha I's, sum of the A I's is 2. Right now, if I take 1/2 of this, then I have to write here 1. And if I intersect this with tuples of non-negative integers, then I get here actually just a set of all unit vectors, right? And so this means that for the alpha i's here, so this means I could take here, and let's do this now, I could take here m equals n, and alpha I equals the ith unit vector. And then this vector v gets the vector of variables just, right? This vector v here, right? And then now let's see now what says now the theorem. It says that the following is equivalent. This quadratic form is a sum of squares. And, okay, what is now is, what are the matrices G with F equals V transpose GV? Well, you see easily that's very exactly a unique one, right? And that's the representing matrix of your quadratic form. So there is only a unique G, right, satisfying this, right? So B becomes now, in our special case, B becomes now, I could just write the representing matrix, and people often call this also Gram matrix actually. Representing matrix of Q, of F is PSD, right? And this becomes F is a sum of n squares, right? And you know, that's something we did. Yeah, you know, that's because we know that all these things are you know, B is actually when equivalent to F is PSD, right? So F is non-negative everywhere, right? So, and we have seen that F is PSD is equivalent to F being a sum of n squares. So we have seen that B prime is equivalent to C if F is a quadratic form. And it was trivial that B prime is equivalent to B, right? And yeah, and we have also seen that A is equivalent to B prime. So in this special case, we have seen this theorem already, right? And here it's similar. It's just that we don't have. So first of all, this matrix is no longer unique, right? So why is it no longer unique? We've seen an example later, but you know, if I have now, so let's, maybe you can think of this Gram. So if you have this Gram matrix here, right? And now you multiply here with this vector x to the alpha 1 up to x to the alpha m, right? And here, if it's transposed, right? And now, for example, so if you have here now, I don't know, you have here, so here, take, take here the ith row, let's say, and jth column, right? And take this entry here, right? This entry contributes to the monomial. So this entry in the ith row and jth column contributes to the monomial, let's see, x to the alpha I, x to the alpha j, which is x to the alpha I plus alpha j. Now the thing is that that another entry could also contribute to this, right? Of course, if I is not equal to j, there is a trivial reason for this, right? Because there is you could look in the ith, because this matrix is symmetric, right? And if you look at the ith column and jth row, right? When you have another such, it's not very well drawn, right? But diagonal would then have to be here somewhere. So you have the mirror entry, right? And that's that will contribute to the same monomial, right? But there is another phenomenon here going on, right? Because there could an entry even somewhere else, right? And its counterpart, of course, that could contribute to the same, right? Because it could happen, of course, that alpha I plus alpha j equals alpha k plus alpha l, right? I mean, if the alpha i's are the unit vectors, then such a thing cannot happen because they are linearly independent. But here it could happen even if ij is different from kl. And therefore several entries can contribute to the same monomial. And so I could rebalance this thing, right? So I could subtract from these two entries a little bit and add to them, right? And so you see this matrix G is no longer unique in general, right? So now you could say, okay, what is the right condition? Maybe I replace it by for all PSD matrices, for all matrices that satisfy this, all these matrices are PSD, right? Or I say there exists one which is PSD. It turns out the right thing is that there exists one that is PSD. And but otherwise, it's very, very, it's very much the same thing when in the case of quadratic forms. It's just that the existence of this matrix, yeah, maybe at first sight you might think, okay, maybe that implies that f is non-negative. Yeah, it does, but it does more. That's the problem, right? It will imply even that f is a sum of squares. And if f is non-negative, doesn't mean that there exists a PSD matrix here. We will see this. Okay. Okay. So now let's just go to the proof. And then we see an example. So now let's go to a proof from A to B. So suppose I have sums of squares representations of f, sums of squares of polynomials, sums of squares of these PIs here. When we know that the support of the PIs lies in 1/2 the Newton polytope of f, right? And but of course also the support consists of tuples of non-negative integers, so I can intersect it with this. And then this is contained by hypotheses in the set of the alpha I. Okay, maybe let's also go to 2, 4, 14 and look at that again. So that was this theorem, right? So that worked actually on an ordered field even. So I should take 2, 4, 15 maybe, right? So I have a sums of squares representation. When I know that the Newton polytope of PIs is contained in 1/2 n of f. So let's take 2, 4, 15, I guess. That would be better. So I think I should correct this in the lecture notes. So, hence there is a matrix A, an L times M matrix, such that, you know, A times V is P1 up to PL. You know, the PIs, all the monomials appearing in PI are the X to the alpha I, right? And these are the monomials that are in this vector V, right? So that means, you know, I can just choose this matrix A such that the rows of A, right? In the rows of A, there are, in each row of A, there are the coefficients of one of these PIs, right? In the corresponding order that corresponds to the order of monomials chosen here. Right, so so in this way I can find this matrix A, right? So okay, it's an L times M matrix because this is of length M, this column vector, and I have L PIs, right? Okay, and when it follows that F is, you know, I can write now f, and that's trivial but very important. I can write the sum of squares as, you know, like an outer product of this vector polynomial, I could say, right? Or polynomial vector, if you like that more. So, row vector times column vector, right? And in this way you see that I can now write this as AV, and this is this vector transpose, so that's AV transpose, right? And now AV transpose is V transpose A transpose, and that's the trick, right? Because A transpose A, I mean, that's a matrix just whose entries are just elements from K, and that's a PSD matrix because it has, it's factorized as A transpose A. And so I put G as A transpose A. And that's a symmetric M by M matrix. And this is PSD by 2, 3, 3. Well, it's quite trivial, right? But that was... but that was this trivial direction here. If you have a factorization, this one actually, then your PSD. Okay, so that was from A to B, and now from B to C. So suppose G is a symmetric M times M PSD matrix with F equals V transpose GV. Then we can, you know, we use now the characterization of PSD matrices in the other way. So we can choose factorization like this, right? And you know, we can actually do this with a square matrix, with an M by M matrix. And then we go the other way around. So now we define polynomial, you know, now we look at AV, V is this vector of monomials. So AV, what is AV? That will be a vector of polynomials. And we call these polynomials VPIs, and then we just calculate that V transpose GV is V transpose A transpose AV, and this AV transpose AV, and that's this vector of polynomials times the same thing as a column vector, and that's the sum of the squares of VPI. Okay, and so that was B implies C, and now from C we have to go to A. So if we have a sum of m squares, when it's a sum of squares, but that's trivial. Okay, so now let's look at this Gram matrix method in practice. Let's do an example. Let K be an Euclidean field, and look at this polynomial 2x1 to the 4 plus 5x2 to the 4 minus x1 squared, x2 squared plus 2x1 to the 3 x2. So it's actually, well, it happens to be a homogeneous polynomial. Well, okay, it's of degree 4. Okay, then let's look at its Newton polytope. You see we have this point is in the support. This point is in the support because of this monomial. Now 2, 2 is also in the support, but that's just the midpoint between 4, 4, 0 and 0, 4. And 3, 1 is also in the support, but that's just, you know, that's just the midpoint between 4, 0 and 2, 2. So actually, you get that the Newton polytope is a convex hull of 4, 0 and 0, 4. It's actually just a line segment. So it's quite small, and that helps, of course. And then I have to look at this 1 half a Newton polytope, which is, of course, the convex hull of 2, 0 and 0, 2. And just the integral points were just the, yes, so when this is 2, 0, 1, 1 and 0, 2. Okay, and so I need, the only monomials I need is x1 squared, x1, x2, and x2 squared. So maybe let's copy this here. Okay, so now we set V to be this vector consisting exactly of these monomials I have mentioned. And now I will have to look if there is a PSD Gram matrix, right? And so I look at these at this affine space of symmetric matrices satisfying this polynomial equation, which I could write at, as a bunch of affine linear equations. And so let's see. So with the top left entry here, that would contribute to x1, 2, or 4, right? So, yeah, I mean, you could also see it in the following way. So it makes sense, you know. Well, let's just write it this way. x1, x2... x2 squared, and then here x1 squared, x1, x2, x2 squared. So what will this entry contribute to? It will contribute to x1 to a 4, right? Is there anybody else who will contribute to x1 to a 4? No, there isn't, right? In the same way that one will contribute, so let's do that will contribute to x1 to a 4, that will contribute to x2 to a 4, and nobody else will do that. And then what will this entry contribute to? That will contribute to x1, x2, x1, 2, or 3, x2, x1, 2, or 3, x2, and that one here will contribute to x1 squared, x2 squared, x1 squared, x2 squared, and of course that one also, right, and due to symmetry, that one will also contribute to x1, 2, or 3, x2. And now let's see this one here, that will contribute to x1 squared, x2 squared also, right? So I can again color it in black, right? So here we have already this kind of phenomenon that several entries contribute to the same thing, even though they are not necessarily mirror images of each other. And then we have here x1, x2, x1, x3 squared. Yes, I think we two others are contributing to x1, x2, 2, 3, right? Okay. So you see, there is here no coefficient with x1, x2 to the 3. So here here there must be a 0, right? Here and here there must be a 0. And this entry you can also determine that must be the 5 here, right? That must be 5. And then we x1, 2, or 3, x2. Well, here I have a coefficient of 2, so I need 1 and 1. Because it must be the same entry, because it's a symmetric matrix. And the x1, 2, or 4 has to be 2. And now here the only thing where I have choices is here, because of this ambiguity. How can we deal with that? So let's say that's an A, and then this is also an A, and we don't know it. But we know that what is here, because this contributes already to A, to the coefficient of x1 squared, x2 squared, we have to add here something so that 2A plus this is minus 1. So this means this must be minus 1 minus 2a, which is written here, right? Okay, so in this way you see how all these matrices G must look like. Okay. And so, you know, that's more or less the thing is you solve a system of linear equations and you represent a general solution in a parametric way. That's what I did here, right? And so we obtain that f is the sum of squares of polynomials if and only if there exists an a in k such that this is PSD, right? And for all a in k, we have... so now how can I test whether there exists such a K? Well, you know, we can test PSDness by looking at, well, there are several methods, right? So what we do here, well, we first look at the principal minors, maybe, right? Principal minors. Okay, well, maybe in general that's a bad idea, but here are not so many, right? Here it's for a 3x3 matrix, it's still possible. And then one of the principal minors is the determinant itself. So what's the determinant? I don't look at the principal minors. I actually look at the coefficients of this anti-characteristic polynomial. Ah, so then I don't have too many things to look at. Yeah, that's maybe better. Okay, so now I build this anti-characteristic polynomial. I add a variable here on the diagonal everywhere. And I compute the determinant. That's 2 plus t times, you know, with Sarrus rule, 2 plus t, which everyone knows for 3x3 matrices gets very easy, right? 2 plus t times t minus 2a minus 1 times 5 plus t, you know, that's this rule. You take this with plus, right? When you multiply these three here, but that gives zero, you add this. When you multiply these three, but that's also zero, right? And now come things, the things that are subtracted. So first of all, the product of these three, right? That's here. And then the product of these three, but that's zero. And then the product of these three, which is subtracted here. Okay. And now I have to multiply it. So I have to expand it. So, okay, so that's a bit tedious. So first we multiply these two terms, when we get... So first I multiply this with t, when I have t squared minus 2at. Normally I would have minus t. But when here afterwards I add 2t, so I write immediately plus t, when I have minus 4a minus 2. So that's really the product of these two. And here I multiply, so here I, what did I do here? So I have here, I have a minus t here. I put it here by putting here 1. When plus a to 3, okay, that becomes this. My plus a squared, that's this, minus 5, right? Okay, good. And when I have to expand this, right, so it's t to the 3 minus 2at squared plus t squared minus 4at minus 2t plus 5t. T squared minus 10at plus 5t minus 20a minus 10, right? Up to here, that's the product of these two expanded, right? And then it goes on like here. Minus 1 plus a squared t plus 2a to the 3 plus a squared minus 5. Okay, now let's see. Let's use a lot of colors. So a T to a 3 is here and here. Then I have, so let's now collect terms with T squared. So I have here minus 2AT squared plus 1, plus 5. So that's this. And then terms with T, minus 4AT minus 2, minus 10AT plus 5, minus 1 plus A squared. So, yes, so minus 2 plus 5 minus 1, that gives a 2 here. When this minus 4 minus 10 gives here a minus 14. And then the minus A squared T is here, right? So that's also all right. And when the things where T does not appear at all, so this gives minus 10, minus 15, minus 28, plus a squared plus 2a to a 3. So I guess it's all right. So. And so we obtain that this is PSD. If and only if the coefficients are non-negative, right? So, of course, leading coefficient is 1 anyway, we don't need to check it. So when we have here 6 minus 2a, that's this, and then 2 minus 14a minus a squared, that's this, and then minus 15 minus 20 plus a squared plus 2a to 3. So yeah, it's really just the same thing. Just using that addition is commutative. Okay, then, so sometimes it's, if you solve inequalities, sometimes it can help to look at the corresponding equation. So that's what we do here. So we take a equal to minus 3, so that this actually is satisfied with equality. So let's look at the other inequalities. So 2a to a 3 plus a squared minus 20a minus 15 is minus 2 times 27 plus 9 plus 60 minus 15. Well, this is minus 54 plus 9 plus 60 minus 15. That's actually 65 minus that's 6 plus 9 minus, that's actually also satisfied with equality here. That's great. Okay, and then this middle one here, minus a squared minus 14a plus 2 is minus 9 plus 42 plus 2 is, that's strictly bigger than 0. And, I didn't take this to be equal. Oh, I see. Okay. So, sorry. I said I took a equal to minus 3 in order to satisfy this, but that was not true. So I take here minus 2a plus 6, that's 12, that's greater than or equal 0. For this reason, f is a sum of squares. That we know now by the Gram matrix method, because we have found this PSD matrix. And, we can even do a little bit better in this in this case. So of course we know also that f is a sum of 3 squares, right? Because our yeah, because we took three monomials. And so this was the other Gram matrix is a 3 by 3, so we know that it is a sum of three squares, but we can even do better. So for this, let's look at this quadratic form. Let's look at this quadratic form with where we choose now a equal to b, a to b minus 3. And let's compute its signature. You know, this quadratic form, if I plug in for t1, so these are new variables, t1, t2, t3. If I plug in the monomials x1 squared, x1, x2, x2 to a 3, then obviously I get back my f, right? Because this vector gets my vector of monomials that I've started with. Now a signature of Q by 2, 3, 2, d is rank of Q, because this is PSD matrix, right? So when the signature is the rank, right? Didn't want to have this in italic. So let me correct this. So the signature is the rank because it's a PSD matrix. But what's the rank? The rank is, you know, so A was minus 3, so this is here 5, and this is minus 3 here. Okay, so let's look. I say the rank is 2, right? Why is the rank 2? Let's do row reduction, right? So I subtract twice the second row from the first. So when I have 0, minus 9, minus 3, and I subtract it from the last, I add it 3 times to the last row. When I have here 15, 5, 1, 5, 0, right? And then I could add, you know, the first column to a second column, or I could subtract it 5 times from a second column. So I get here 0. And you see that, now the first and the last row are scalar multiples of each other. So rank is 2. And okay, and then we can do even a bit better than 3 squares. So Q is the sum of 2 squares of linear forms. We know it. And thus F is the sum of 2 squares of polynomials, right? Yes, so yeah, you know, you remember that if you can write Q as a difference of sums of squares of linear forms, and the signature is and the rank is the number of total terms in this sum, in this sum of differences, and the signature is the difference, and so that's why Q is the sum of 2 squares of linear forms. And thus F is the sum of 2 squares of polynomials, right? Because I know I get it from Q by substituting the Ti variables with these monomials. But if I have the sum of squares of linear forms and I do this substitution, then I get the sum of squares of polynomials, of 2 polynomials. To compute this, and one can actually compute this representation explicitly, right? Because I can compute this representation at sum of sums of linear forms. So how do we do this? That was, you know, we start. So let's look again at the matrix. Where I have now set A to minus 3. Okay, so it's 2t1 squared plus 2t1t2 minus 6, because a is minus 3, right? Minus 6t1t3 plus 5t2 squared, because a is minus 3, that's 6 minus 1, plus 5t3 squared. And now, you know, we try to hide step by step variables in squares of linear forms. So first, the first variable we want to eliminate is the t1. And so I have two t1, yeah, and every term where t1 appears, I, you know, if you have a 2 and 2, 1 plus 1 half t2 minus 3 half. Here you see that gives all terms with t1. But when you have to subtract minus 2 times the square of these things in order to correct again, and then you take also, you shouldn't forget the terms where t1 does not appear. They are here. So, and that's my first linear form here. So that's 2 linear form L1 squared. And when this is, 9 half t3 squared. So I'm confused. Ah, because I have here 5t3. Okay. Because I have 5t2 squared. So normally that would be 1/2 t minus 1. That would be minus 1/2 t2 squared. But when I have plus 10/2 t2 squared, yes, right. And then the mixed term here is, minus 3 minus, and then plus, actually, t2, t3. Yeah, that comes just from a mixed term here. And then I have, and then I have here 9 over 4 t3 squared, but when times 2, 9 over 4, so I have minus 2 times 9 over 4 t3 squared plus 5 t3 squared. But that's minus 9/2 t3 squared plus 10/2 t3 squared. And that gives just this 1/2 t3 squared, right? So now this is, two L1 squared, and now I want to eliminate the T2, I guess. So I have 9/2 T2 plus 1/3 T3, because when this will give, 1/9 if I square it, and when times 9, and then divide by 2 again, 1/9 t3, 1/9, okay, so a mixed term first, 2 t2 t3, so 2/3 t2 t3. But when divided by 2/3, 9/3, that gives this, right? Right, exactly. So this 1/3 has been adjusted, so exactly where it gives this. And when I get here 1/9 t3 squared, and by chance this gives exactly this, so I'm already done already. Well, by chance, I knew that it must be this way because the rank was 2 and the signature was 2. So that's 2 L1 squared plus 9/2 L2 squared. So these are my two linear forms. Write it explicitly again. Write L1 and L2 explicitly again. And now I substitute for the TIs where the monomials I had, right? So here, here, here. And it must hold here, right? You can verify, but it must be true. Okay. So we have even calculated the sums of squares representations. So we have learned a lot how to find sums of squares representations, how to calculate them. And so sums of squares of polynomials, right? So you see sums of squares of polynomials seems to be quite easy to deal with, right? Actually, you could say much more about this. You could talk about semi-definite programming and so on. Whereas sums of squares of rational functions is a quite difficult thing. Okay, thank you very much. So this ends the second chapter on Hilbert's 17th problem, but we will come back to non-negative polynomials later, to positive polynomials also. Also in the next chapter, we will prove a much more general characterization of polynomials that are maybe positive or non-negative or vanishing just on a subset defined by other polynomials. Okay, we will need refined approach, so we need more techniques. It will not be sufficient to work with preorders and orders of fields, but we will have to work with preorders of commutative rings, and actually we will need an analog to orders also for rings, and that will be the so-called prime cones. Okay, thank you a lot for listening, and goodbye.